Welcome to the second lecture in Trauma and Orthopaedics for Medical Students based on the Medical Licensing Assessment. In this talk, we're going to cover everything, hopefully, that you need to know about fractures. So as you can see from the Medical Licensing Assessment, this covers a presentation and a number of conditions. So very simply, what is a fracture? Well, remember, this is a soft tissue injury that has an associated break in the cortex of the bone. The reason for phrasing it like this is you have to remember that what we look at a lot of the time is x-rays, and what we're really dealing in is a soft tissue injury as well as what we can see on the x-rays. So in this talk, we're going to cover the types of fracture, describing a fracture, some special situations, the fundamentals of how you manage a fracture in principle, and then a little bit on what an open fracture is and how you manage those. So these are the, broadly speaking, the causes of fractures. There are others. The majority are traumatic, which can be direct, a direct blow, or indirect, and such as a twisting injury. They can be pathological fractures, which may be tumour, which could be primary or secondary, or insufficiency due to some form of metabolic syndrome or osteoporosis. And then the third group are the fatigue or stress fractures. These are the overuse fractures. And you can see in the x-ray of the foot there, this is a stress fracture of one of the metatarsals. So we're going to start with how you describe a fracture, and this always seems to worry students, but it's actually pretty straightforward. So first of all, identify the bone. You're going to name the bone that's broken and the location in the bone. We'll come to that. And then the displacement, the pattern of the fracture. So the location is pretty simple, and you can divide it up into thirds, proximal, middle, distal. You can describe it as the epiphysis in a child, or the metaphysis, which is the bit next to the epiphysis, or the diaphysis, which is the shaft. And then whether it is intra-articular or not. So just describe it broadly in the bone. There are a number of different classic fracture patterns which are illustrated here. So as you can see, a transverse fracture goes straight across, and you can imagine a direct blow or a loading force will do this. If you put a little bit of a twist on it, you'll get an oblique fracture, more of a twist, and you can imagine the bone rotating around, giving you a spiral fracture. If the bone is broken into a number of pieces, this is a comminuted fracture, and these can be in line, as they are in this illustration, or they can be moved around. And a classic example of this is the thing called a butterfly fragment, where there's one extra bit. A segmental fracture is, as you see there, where you have a bit of the tube in the middle and a bit at each end, and then a couple of special ones. So an avulsion fracture, these are more common in younger people, where you have a strong ligament attached to the bone and the failure point is the bone rather than the ligament. The opposite of that is an impaction fracture, where there is effectively a crush injury into the bone and it gets driven in. And then the torus and the green stick fractures are sort of incomplete fractures, they're classically paediatric. So if we now look at displacement, and a bone can displace in any direction. So you have to describe translation, angulation, rotation and shortening. So translation, very simply, is a move from one side or the other. And you describe it as whether it's going towards the midline or away from the midline, or superior, inferior. Just describe it in relation to the anatomical position of the bone. And we'll come to that. Angulation, same thing. And you describe this in terms of roughly how many degrees. And we always describe these things in relation to where the distal bit is going. We know where the proximal bit is because it's attached to the rest of the body. It's where the distal bit is going, whether it's bending towards the midline or away from the midline. So you've got varus or valgus. The bone can rotate as well. You can imagine a spiral fracture. The knee might be fixed the ankle rotates and the tibia spirals round. So you describe the rotation, and you can describe that in sort of degrees. And then you can have a combination. So you can have translation and angulation. So you'd say in this one, it's translated about 50% and it's angulation about 45 degrees. And then in a lot of bones, you'll get shortening with the muscle pull. So just describe roughly how much shortening you see. This is all descriptive. Nobody's going to pin you down and go, oh, it's not quite a half, it's a little bit less. Just describe what you see. So when you come to actually looking at an X-ray, there are a number of things you have to do. You have to describe the view, whether it's an AP or a lateral, and what it is. Is it a pelvic X-ray? Is it a forearm X-ray? Remember to check that it's the right patient, that it's the right date. It's not one from last year. And if appropriate, comment on the skeletal maturity. You can say this is a child or this is skeletally mature. Now, that can be a little bit tricky when you're starting out, but you'll get the hang of it. And then we really do this ABCs. So are these suitably penetrated pictures? Can you actually see what you want to see? What's the bone quality like? And then what's the fracture configuration that we've just talked about? Does it involve the joint? And can you see anything obvious in the soft tissues? Is there obvious break in the soft tissues? Do they have a gas in the soft tissues? And again, once you get used to these things, you'll see them. So here we go. We'll go through a few of these. So here is a fracture of the fibula. So you can describe a fracture of the fibula. It is the distal fibula. It is extra-articular. The bone has got, what would you call that, either an oblique or possibly a short spiral fracture. That there is a little bit of translation, probably 25 to 50%, going laterally. That there is probably not much in the way of angulation, no real rotation, and there is a little bit of shortening. You can see probably 5 millimetres of shortening on this one. We'll do a few more. So here we go with the fracture of the clavicle. So you can see it's a fracture of the mid shaft of the clavicle. It's probably a short oblique, maybe transverse. There is comminution. You can see that little fragment that's highlighted there. It's translated by 100% or more. Probably isn't any angulation. You can't really tell about rotation. And it's short. It's probably a centimetre or so short, where you can see the lateral side has migrated medially. Can't really comment on the soft tissues here. Here is a humeral fracture, a slightly different fracture pattern. So you could say this is a transverse fracture of the junction of the middle and the distal thirds, maybe. That it's translated at least 100%, probably not angulated. Can't comment on the rotation, but it doesn't really look like. And it's not, if anything, it's not shortened. It's actually distracted. You can imagine the pull of the arm on this one. So here is a form of olecranon fracture. So this is intra-articular is the first thing you can say about it. And you can do the same things. So you can say, is it translated? Well, not really. This is more of an avulsion injury because the triceps is attached to that fragment and it's pulled it away. So the fracture is distracted. There probably is angulation there because you can see the two fragments are apart. And there isn't rotation, but this is an intra-articular injury. And here's another one of the tibia. So you can say here we've got an AP of the lower leg and a lateral of the lower part of the tibia and the ankle. On the AP, you can see that there is a spiral fracture of the tibia, but no obvious fracture of the fibula at the same height, but if you look carefully, there is a fracture of the fibula more proximally. So this is a spiral fracture. It's translated again about 50%. It looks rotated. You can imagine the little spike on the distal bit. If you rotated the leg around, it would fit neatly into that little other spike. So it is rotated, probably not particularly shortened, and not angulated. And on the lateral, you can say, well, I can see a fracture. I can't really tell you what sort of pattern it is. It's probably spiral, but it's not displaced in an AP direction. It's not rotated, obviously, in an AP direction on this, and it's not shortened. Just say what you can see. And here's another one. So this is a femoral fracture. And if you look carefully at the AP of the femur, you can see that the physes are open. So this is a pediatric fracture. So we've got an AP and a lateral of the femur. There is a spiral fracture of the femur. It is translated 100%. It is not angulated. But if you look carefully at the AP, you've got almost an AP of the hip. But if you look carefully down at the bottom, that little thing at the knee, that is the patella, and the patella is pointing sideways. So this is rotated by about 90 degrees. And it's a bit short. You can see where the spike on the distal bit of the femur would probably fit into the other bit proximally. And this is the pull of the muscles. And here is a fracture. Again, there are lots of bones. Clearly some breaks in it. Just take your time. Again, you can see there are open growth plates at the wrist. So this is a pediatric fracture. There is a fracture of the midshaft of the radius and a midshaft of the ulna. We have an AP of the forearm and a lateral of the forearm. And then you just work your way through. So you say, with the radius, it's a transverse fracture. And on the AP, it is translated minimally. No shortening, no rotation. On the lateral, you can say, transverse fracture. This one is not translated, but it is angulated. And you describe the direction. So this is actually going dorsally, because if you think about it in the anatomical position, it's bending backwards. And then when you look at the ulna, you describe it on the AP. So you can say it's transverse. It is translated laterally because it's going towards the radius. Not particularly angulated, but it is a little bit short. And actually, it's the very same pattern on the lateral, just to say what you see. Now, there are some special things. So we're going to talk about dislocations, intra-articular fractures, pathological fractures, and hip fractures. So dislocations can be difficult. The most common one is the shoulder. So here we've got classic AP x-ray of the shoulder. And then the other picture, you can see some of the obvious anatomical things that you're looking for, just to get your bearings. So on this picture, the bottom left one is normal. If you look at the one in the middle, the humeral head is in front of the glenoid, or it could be behind the glenoid, but it's clearly not pointing at the glenoid, and therefore there is a dislocation. You now need another view to work out whether it's in front or behind. So on the third x-ray with the red arrow is pointing at the tip of the coracoid bone. Now we know the coracoid is at the front, and therefore the humeral head is next to the coracoid, so this is an anterior dislocation. And you can't comment on the direction of a dislocation until you've got that second view. Intra-articular fractures, again, you describe what you see, and we're not going to go into these in detail, but you can see on this knee on the left that there is a fracture that runs up into the knee joint, displacing the lateral tibial condyle, and it's got some fragments in there, so you could call it comminuted. The fracture actually goes across the proximal tibia, because you can see on the medial side there's a little line there. And if you look at the one of the ankle, this is very difficult to describe. You can say it's multifragmentary, intra-articular, comminuted of the distal tibia and the distal radius. Difficult to say much more than that, and probably you're going to get a CT scan. So pathological fractures are typically the lytic ones. So these come as metastases, or it could be something like a myeloma. And you see these lytic lesions, and they weaken the bone. They can be solitary, or they can be multiple, as you see here. So both of these femurs have got lytic lesions. We'll talk a little bit about hip fractures, and we'll cover them again in some more detail in the hip lecture. So these can be intracapsular or extracapsular. Now, the capsule runs around the neck of the femur and runs up to a line between the two trochanters, the lesser and the greater trochanter. This is the intertrochanteric line. And that's important because the blood supply to the femoral head runs in that capsule. So if you displace the capsule, you cut off the blood supply to the head and you get avascular necrosis. So if you have an intracapsular fracture, you've damaged the blood supply to the head. This example is extracapsular. So the fracture line, you can see the red line on the right there, is between the two trochanters. Now the lesser trochanter has come off in this one, but the blood supply is still up and down that bit. So the blood supply to the head is still intact. So this is extracapsular. And it's an important distinction to make when we come to the treatment. We now look at the principles of fracture management. This is relatively simple stuff. The aim is to reduce the fracture, so line it up, to immobilize it while it heals, and then physiotherapy or rehabilitation to get it moving again. And broadly speaking, your management is going to be conservative or surgical. And remember, with surgery, there are absolute contraindications, which is infection, the medical conditions, if the patient isn't fit enough, or poor soft tissues. So if they've got a lot of soft tissue damage, that may preclude you to operating. Then again, it may also be an indication for surgery. So this is a generalized algorithm, and we'll run through it in bits. So does the fracture need to be reduced? If it is a totally undisplaced fracture, say in the little toe, it doesn't need anything to it, so it doesn't need to be reduced. Do you need to immobilize it? Well, you can wrap it up in a cast or a brace or a sling. If it's not displaced and doesn't need to be reduced, you just immobilize it. If it does need to be reduced, then can you reduce it closed? And this means, can I manipulate it closed? If I can, then manipulate it and then treat it with your cast or your brace, whatever you want. And then you're going to have another look. Is it stable? Is it staying where it's supposed to be? And this is where the fracture clinics come in. If it is, you carry on. If it's not, you operate. So your other arm of that is, can it be reduced closed? Can I manipulate this thing closed? Imagine a femur fracture. Can I grab that femur and line it up with my bare hands? No. So I'm going to have to do a surgical reduction. And if I'm going to do a surgical reduction, I probably should go on and do a surgical stabilization. So broadly speaking, if I can reduce it closed, can I treat it closed? Yes or no. If I'm going to reduce it open, then I'm going to operate. And there are other more complicated bits in here, but this, broadly speaking, is what you need to know. And nobody is going to ask you exactly how you're going to treat any one fracture, because there are lots of variables, such as the rest of the patient, that go into it. So let's look at some methods of fixation. Conservative ones, these are the closed reduction ones. You could do nothing. If you break your little toe, you probably won't bother doing anything about it. You can just strap things together. So you can strap your toes together, or buddy strap, this is called, the fingers together. And you've probably seen people wandering around with this. You leave it there until it heals. You use the good finger to splint the bad finger. You may put the patient in a cast. So we do this for clavicle fractures, proximal humeral, in a sling, clavicle fractures, proximal humeral fractures, that sort of thing. And you're sure you've all seen people in a cast for a distal radial fracture or a scaphoid fracture. And these are very, very good treatments. They all work. If we look at surgical, which is open bits, there are two ways of doing this. This is external fixation and internal fixation. So external fixation means we put something in to hold it that comes out of the skin. We may open the fracture first to line everything up, but we may choose to put one of these things on. So you can see there in the hand, these are K wires, little smooth pins. You put those in, wait till the fracture heals, take them out. And then you've got forms of what's called an external fixator. So these are pins that go into the bone. And then you can use these circular frames or what's called a unilateral frame. And you can use these as definitive treatment or temporary treatment before you do something else to them. The next option is internal fixation. So there are a number of forms of this, and what you choose is based on the fracture that you actually have to treat and the patient. So in this hand x-ray, you can see a screw in the scaphoid. So that's a single solitary screw which compresses the scaphoid fracture. In this proximal humeral fracture, you can see there is a plate on the outside of the bone and multiple screws in the bone. So the screws are there to hold the fracture together, and the plate is there to hold the whole construct to make it more stable. And you'll see this in other bones in the forearm, sometimes in the femur and the tibia. You can then do a thing called an intramedullary nail. So this is a typically titanium rod that is passed down through a small incision at the top. So typically in this one in the hip. So you make a little incision by the hip, pass the rod down the inside of the bone, and then percutaneously put some screws in it to keep it fixed. This has a lot of biomechanical advantages because it's very rigid. Patient gets up and walks on it straight away. Technically slightly more difficult to do and isn't suitable for all fractures. It's very good for the pathological fractures, as you can see in that hip x-ray on the right, because this spans the whole bone. And we know if this person's got metastases, they've got one, they're likely to get another one. So if we're going to operate, we want to treat the whole bone rather than just the one we can see. And a very special form of internal fixation is a thing called a tension band wire, which is a couple of these fine, smooth pins and a wire that's looped round through the bone and round the pins, which generates a compressive force. This is exclusively used in the patella and, as you can see here, in the olecranon. It looks rather Heath Robinson, but actually works very, very well. Although quite often these pins irritate, you have to take them out again later. And your final option is to replace it. So if it's a rounder joint, it may not be practical to try to fix it. And the intracapsular hip fractures we know don't do well if we fix them, and therefore we replace them. And sometimes around the shoulder, we'll replace the shoulder. And sometimes you can do it around the knee as well if you need to. So that is your final option. So there are all these different things you can do. And they very much depend on the fracture pattern and the patient, how they're going to get around, are they bedbound, are they healthy, what's their job. All of these things will get thrown into the mix to pick the treatment that's individual. So we're not going to ask you at finals, apart from possibly hip replacement, hip hemiarthroplasty, what the definitive treatment is, because there are too many variables there. So we'll go back to the hip fractures again. As I said, they are intracapsular, which is undisplaced or displaced, and extracapsular. And the intracapsular have a damaged blood supply. The extracapsular, it's intact. This is it again. So you can see this is an intracapsular displaced fracture, so it has a damaged blood supply. And these are the ones that we're going to treat with a hemiarthroplasty. We're going to replace the hip. And this means the patient can get up and walk on it the next day, and we get them out of hospital as fast as possible. The extracapsular has this intact blood supply, as you can see here. This means that it will heal. So we use a thing called a dynamic hip screw. This is a two-part construct. So the screws fix into a plate that has a hollow barrel. And that screw that you can see slides up and down. So if you get compression and collapse of the fracture site, the screw juts out a little bit, but it allows the whole thing to compress and heal. So we now move on to open fractures. So an open fracture is that break in the cortex of the bone with an associated break in the skin. And we worry about these because there is more soft tissue damage, which means there's going to be muscle, nerve, and blood vessel injury risk. There is more opportunity for infection, not only because more bugs can get in through this big open wound, but because you've got dead muscle, which acts as a substrate for bugs to grow. With this increased blood vessel and soft tissue stripping, you get delayed and non-union. And remember that the trauma to the patient is likely to be greater, so they're going to be sicker people. Now, people worry, they panic when they see big open fractures. What you've got to remember is that your primary goal is to treat the patient. So A, B, C, D, E, the ATLS stuff, look after the airway, the breathing, the circulation, and then move on to the disability, the deformity, all that sort of stuff. So you've done your ABCs and you're going to do a few other things. You're going to give them broad spectrum antibiotics because these are an infection risk and you want to start the antibiotics as soon as you can. You're going to give them antitetanus because these are open wounds and you never come quite sure. So the standard is to give antitetanus unless you absolutely know they've had one recently. You're going to give them analgesia. These things hurt. And this is all basic stuff. None of this is particularly novel. You're going to give them big broken bone, lots of trauma. You're going to give them some analgesia. You're going to give them a splint. And you can use anything you like. So this is one full of beans and you put it in, you suck it and it compresses around the joint, around the fracture, and it makes it very, very stable. And there are a couple of reasons for doing this. One is it gives you analgesia. You stop that fracture from moving, it's much more comfortable for the patient. And secondly, it stops those spikes of bone damaging the soft tissues more. So you're protecting them from the future and you're giving them pain relief just by putting a splint on. And the simplest splint for a femur or tibial fracture is to tie the legs together. Use the other leg as a splint for the first leg until you get to hospital. You're going to take a photograph because you want to know what this wound looks like. And so do all the senior people who are going to be involved in the operation. And it's much easier to take a photograph and present them with a picture and say, this is what we're dealing with, than have them all have to come down and have a look. And you can put these photographs in the patient records in a lot of hospitals. Once you've taken your photograph, you want to cover it with a dressing because that way no more bugs get in. If you put the dressing on before the photograph, then you have to take the dressing off again. So just think about that. Take your photograph, put a dressing on. And then you're going to get your x-ray. So you do all of this stuff, then you get your x-ray so that everybody knows what you're dealing with. And then they're going to get an operation. But this is right down the bottom of the list. You can do all of this stuff very simply in the A&E department before you call the orthopaedic team. And if you do the A, B, C, D, E bit first, then you get this right. If you can't remember it, it's all the A's. It's a little bit of a fudge, I know, but it gives you something to, when you're sitting there in the A&E department, looking at this big open wound, you're trying to remember. So I've taken you through a little bit about fractures and hopefully enough to get you through the MLA. So we now know how to describe a fracture, how to describe which way the bones are going. We know some of the principles of management of fractures, whether we need to do it open or closed, and then what sort of fixation we might want to think about. And we talked a little bit about how you manage an open fracture, just in case you come across one of those. So hopefully you found this useful, and please do look at the other talks in the series.